video to give you some history on David. I'm going to have David come up and speak with me for a few minutes, and then we're going to bring David the second up. And this is a very rare opportunity where these two gentlemen, I think they may have come together one other time before where you may have interviewed him for YPO. Mm-hmm. But this is the first time they're coming together and being interviewed together. So Prophet Marcia was right. This is exciting for me. I am a St. Louis fan. Anything about St. Louis, I love. And that's what these guys do as well. These companies could be anywhere, anywhere in this country. David started, when I first met David, I think he was in one building, maybe 4,000 square feet. And I went out to a reception and they had a board out. You know how they have these bulletin boards or poster boards out. And he was showing his sales going to $300 million. And I said to myself, as a cynical banker, yeah, right. $300 million. Now that was quite a while ago. He's at $17 billion now. He had 4,000 square feet. Now he has 9,000 employees. He has more employees than he started off in square footage. And his story is great. He has a lot of stuff out on YouTube. You guys can go see it. Did a lot of interviews. One I really like is the one he did with Bishop T.D. Jakes. But his beginning, when I first met him, I didn't know his start, his beginning, and how he came when he first got started in this business and his humble beginnings. Now, he says he was born in Chicago. He's really a St. Louis. Well, he's been here longer than anywhere else. But he went to Clinton. He grew up in Clinton, Missouri. So I want to give you just a little bit of background on him, and we're going to keep this thing moving very quickly. And then we'll get David up, and you'll hear some of his story, because we do want you guys to think big. One thing I love about him and his son is the fact that they have a vision. One time we were going to this event in Chicago, and we were driving there. And people, you know, I was going with them because they didn't want to see me. They wanted me to get him to come. So I got him to come to the event, and I introduced him. But when we were driving in the car, he said, you know, I call this company Worldwide Technology, but I should have called it Universal Wide. And I remember saying to myself, man, this guy has a vision that's unlike anybody I know, any of the small companies, mid-sized companies I have ever worked with. So that's his vision. And I heard the interview recently with his son, same type of thing. So it's in his DNA, same type of vision. But we're going to show a quick video of a little history on David so you have a quick idea what that is, how he grew up, and where this entrepreneurial spirit came from.
I would love when people say I can't do something or it's not possible. Well, those are really very, very encouraging words for me. I grew up in Clinton, Missouri, milking cows and slopping hogs. We didn't have an indoor bathroom as well, so part of my responsibilities also was taking out the chamber pot. I had a mother and father that were caring, that were committed to that next generation. First entrepreneur I ever saw out of necessity was my father. He had a janitorial service. He had a trash route. In 1957, was going into the first grade. Ku Klux Klan said, we're not going to integrate these schools. We're going to do everything we possibly can to keep this from happening in Clinton, Missouri. So my dad patrolled the town all night to ensure his five kids go to school safely. I went to the University of Central Missouri. During the summer months, I would come to St. Louis, stay with my older brother, and work in the rail yards as a trackman, hauling ties, digging out the track, and hauling rail. It was hard, tough labor. And as I began to think about what does the future hold, I wanted to be a part of the technological revolution that was going on, because I knew that if I could be a part of that, I could be a part of reshaping, redefining business and the way people did business. I knew there was going to be an uphill battle. I had two children, a mortgage. We were living from paycheck to paycheck, just trying to keep things going. Marrying right was extremely important. She was there from the time that we started the initial business to the time that I got my car repossessed to the time that we now done well. the breadth and depth of opportunities that we have, the culture that allows you to be all that's possible. Our competitive edge in this country is our ability to be able to preserve that. I have a personal obligation for that next generation to understand that whatever gift they have is significant to preserving the competitiveness and the greatness that this country is and has provided for them.
Just looking at your history, some of the things I knew, about when you got your car repossessed, you mentioned that on there, and we'll get to that. We'll talk about that. But first, I'm going to say this before he says it. I have the distinct pleasure of turning him down for a loan. Now, I didn't. Now, I worked at Mercantile Bank, and he sent some guy over there to talk to me, and this guy turned out not to be so savory. And then he came over to see me. I think this is when the bank was on Grand and Lindell. But this is the amazing part of the story. I think he was doing like $8 million in sales from the financial statements I saw. But again, we didn't fall out. He didn't get discouraged. Optimism kept going. And we were able to, I was able to bring him back to the bank. We were able to get him away from the factoring folks and that contract financing. We brought him back to Mercantile. I think we did like a $10 million deal. I mean, again, every bank wants to do business with him now, so he doesn't have a problem with that. But I was glad to be a part of that, glad to redeem myself and be a part of his history. But I told him, I told him I was going to say this first before he got it out there. But here's the story. It's like Mike, who remembers the coach that fired Michael Jordan from his high school team? Do you guys remember his name? No, right? So I told him, I was like, Michael, when I turn you down for that loan, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. So when I turned you down for that loan, that helped to make you the man you are today and help worldwide to become what it is today. So I take credit for that. Success has many fathers. So everybody that ever had any conversations with him are going to try to claim credit for him being $17 billion in sales. Now,
let me respond to that. I will only say this. His grace is sufficient. His mercy is new every day.
There you go.
And the truth will set you free.
All right. I told the truth. Well, this event is called the Faith Summit. And we've been working to get David to an event. I think we start off with the Father's Day. And weekends are extremely busy for him, so I knew that. But we were working, okay, we got to find something where he can come and be with us. So we had something we thought set up last year, the leadership conference. But as God would have it, this faith summit and the theme, relentless faith, I think is the right spot at the right time for you to be here. So, you might, I know the services on Thursday and Friday are usually not like this where you do a fireside chat. You usually have a fiery preacher preach. But this is an appropriate conversation and interview because of who we have here, David Senior, or David and David II, because they use relentless faith to grow these companies. Now you said your father, out of necessity, was an entrepreneur, and past generations we had to do what we had to do, right, to survive. But now you had an excellent job at FedEx, and I mean again he was also the first African American salesperson, I think, at Missouri Pacific. And then he left there and went to FedEx and was the top salesman at FedEx. So he was doing well. But you didn't have to become an entrepreneur out of necessity. What drove you to start your own company?
I had two people in my life that affected my life. And never discount what men, godly men, do for you and guiding you in your life. And there were many of them that were there, but my grandfather and dad were really, really inspirational to me, but they set the bar pretty high of what's possible. They worked hard, but they were men of faith as well, and they looked beyond their circumstances. And when I see them and their example, Hebrews 11 comes to mind. Faith is the substance of things to hope for, and evidence of things not seen, and belief in the unseen, looking beyond your circumstances. Because they were living in a, seeing them in the 50s and 60s where there was true racism, true segregation and bigotry, and you know, it was, and it was thick and it was in your face. And for them to walk and create their own opportunities, you create your own opportunities. You know, and you've got gifts that in many instances, you know, that you unrealized gifts that you have. And I remember thinking about this as I was watching them and thinking back on them in a whole bit, and they had to think in faith.
Right.
They had to think also there was a Ephesians 3:20 comes to mind. It says, "Glory be to God that works within us, that can do exceedingly above all that you can think, dream, or pray for." You know, and so to see them have janitorial service, see them have trash hauling service, seeing them being master mechanics, seeing them milking cows and slopping hogs. My dad came from the city. He came from Chicago, Illinois, and he's in Clinton, Missouri, following the love of his life, you know, with these five kids at the time, and now eight kids, trying to feed and provide for them when not everybody's going to be fair-handed about job opportunities, even though you're skilled and capable of it. And so out of necessity, created opportunities for himself to provide for his family with support of a loving spouse at home. My mother and father were married for 54 years before my dad passed away.
Amen.
And so... an example of marriage. I've been married for 47 years now.
Amen, amen. And I think another part of the secret of your success, and we'll get to the other secrets, one of them is your wife, Thelma, and that's because she's a Soldan High School alum. Any Tigers in the audience? but thinking of that theme, relentless faith, what does that mean to you personally? And professionally, looking at the success that Worldwide has had,
so you
know, relentless, being dogged, stubborn, et cetera.
So I would say to you that my wife probably has more faith than I do, and has more, she is a kingdom builder, because from the standpoint that I'm answering the call that God gave me, she has belief in God through me. Hmm. And so you think about this, is that I started a business in 1983. Everybody talks about 1990, but I was prepared in 1983. She supported me. She supported me when it wasn't Worldwide Technology. It was four people and five people and 4,000 square feet. She supported me when I didn't have a job. She supported me when I started a company and bought a company with no money in 1983. And then evolved that into a company that did something that no one's ever done, and it's an undercharge audits in 87 with the railroad industry, and built some of the first networks in 1987. And to solve a business problem. The reason I got in technology, I was solving a business problem and to do the undercharge audits for the railroads. And so out of that necessity, am I in the business of auditing, doing undercharge audits for the railroads, or am I in the business of using technology in a new and revolutionary way to solve a business problem?
Yeah, that's excellent. And I heard you describe yourself as a non-IT person that started an IT company. That's a miracle within itself.
Yeah. The Lord will provide what you need. He always had for me. Hmm. You know, I'm not a software engineer. I'm not technical. I have to have words. Mary has to show me how to turn the doggone thing on, and I navigate to where I need to go to.
Over that way.
but God gives me concepts and structures and solving problems and how to leverage technology. I'm not a specialist in AI either, but I understand the concept of how to translate that into something very, very special and useful. I'm into to artificial intelligence now to a degree that I understand the principles behind it, and I can always get the technical talent. You know, it says my people perish for the lack of vision. You know, and then comes under that a strategy around that vision. Then comes a plan around that, and I'm very good at seeing the future. And God gives me visions around what's possible, what I should be doing, and how I should be leveraging that platform in a way that serves others and serves our society, serves our community in ways that only He has gifted and blessed me to do. And then people follow vision. They just do. And especially if they know who you serve. It's not about serving me. Anytime I've sat down with some of the biggest companies in the world, I've always talked about, how do I serve you? And some of those, the entrepreneurial spirit is not necessarily alive in the major companies you hear a lot about. Innovation comes from small business. Innovation comes from people who have the courage to recognize the power that works within them. Yes. And act upon it. Faith without corresponding works is dead.
Right. Now, you hear David talk like this. He talks like this wherever he goes. Now, you know, as a corporate person myself, been in corporate America and private equity for 40 years, they told you, or it was an unspoken rule, you don't talk about religion, you don't talk about politics. He talks like this everywhere. Now, I guess when you're $17 billion in sales, you can say whatever you want. But this is before he became $17 billion in sales. But everybody looks at the success now and all the awards, and you know they're calling him to be a part of the Blues and the NASCAR and things like that. I mean, he has a vision, and we're going to get into some of that. But tell these aspiring entrepreneurs that are out here in the audience and online some of the difficult times, the challenges. You know, we heard about the car being repossessed, and you were chasing the guy in the tow truck, but that was because he had your briefcase. You didn't necessarily want the car back. But I also heard that on that was it the same day? The lights went out? And different day, but kind of talk about some of those challenges. And you call her your mother in love when she called you and encouraged you in one of your darker moments.
Well, you know, we are I'm surrounded by women of faith, and deep faith. My mom was a woman of deep faith, and so forth. My mother in love is a mother of deep faith, and the whole bit as well. It was a very difficult and challenging time. I had to have my car repossessed, and then to find out that, you know, one of our guys had reallocated about $800,000, which is
that's the guy I turned down for the loan.
That was a lot of money during that period of time. I mean, this is 1993 or so, mm-hmm. So it kind of put us upside down with the bank. The bank was really challenged to see how we're going to, you know, navigate through this as well. I had these pending government contracts and so forth as well that I was trying to navigate as well, trying to put some financing in place to structure that and bridge that. And the banks were actually trying to prosecute and trying to shut us down. And they did their forensics, and they looked and found out that, well, why would I steal for myself, right?
Right.
You know, and found out all these issues and challenges and so forth, you know. And so it as you talk about, it made me better and more resolved around not only making sure you got the right people, but also making sure that the culture is right. that the kind of relationship and kind of core values that I believe in, and these core values, from my standpoint, line up with the Word of God. And that's one of the reasons that we've been designated. This year, we just announced 12 years in a row, best places to work. And not only here in the U.S., but in Europe and in London, I mean, and also in Asia and so forth, that does not exclusively focus on the United States. And so just to you were saying.
Psalm 91. And when your mother-in-law called you.
Oh, yeah, my mother-in-law called me. Sorry, I've got to get back to that. So for some strange reason, a storm came through. It was kind of a dark day. It was kind of a dark overall to me, and as I recall. And I was sitting in my office in a whole bit. I was kind of in despair in a whole bit. And this call came in, and it was happened to be my mother-in-law. And she said, you know, I heard about kind of what happened and what was going on. She said, trust in God. And then she said, let's pray. And that's what we did. We prayed. And then we read through Psalms 91. Psalms 91. And so I read Psalms 91 every day, over and over and over again, just to remind me where my help comes from, who protects me, who guides me, who advises me, who's my counselor, where my strength comes from. And that was one of the most significant moments to a very difficult time. And follow the light. That light came in. God inspired her to call me at that moment.
Amen. 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 Before I bring David the second up, the one thing that if you're in a meeting with David, you know, at least 10 times he'll say a particular word that I'll change that L to an R, and that's relationship. And he talks about faith. But I noticed in looking at your history, you talked about how those relationships you established at FedEx when you were a number one salesman. You brought those over to you, to Worldwide Technology, and you built those relationships, the question I want to ask you is, what advice do you have for young entrepreneurs today? But those relationships, and what I noticed in the way you did things or do things, there's no experience or no job that you had that you didn't learn from and that you didn't take to the next step. But what would your advice be? The relationships you built and how that's really sustained you, how you really developed those relationships, and you don't burn bridges. What would your advice be to young entrepreneurs, those aspiring to be in business?
So I would say to any entrepreneur, anybody that is, whether you're an entrepreneur now or not, nothing else happens unless you sell something.
Right.
I mean, sell something, that's and right. You sell something by building a relationship. And people do business with people they like and they trust. You don't have to, I mean, that's how business is done. And I've been doing business that way for many, many years. And I hold myself accountable to something I think that's really powerful that I think you might want to think about. I'd like for you to go out to the fruits of the Spirit. Go out to the fruits of the Spirit. Because one of the things I do is I hold myself accountable to what I can be accountable for in that relationship. I can't be accountable for what they do and how they act, but I can be a light for them. So my mother said this a long time ago. She said, you may be the only Bible they may see that day. And when I think about the fruits of the Spirit, and what I hold myself accountable to, I would suggest this, I would recommend this to you in every relationship you have, with your family, or with a neighbor, or with a friend, or with, because reputation matters in that light being showing through as well. And so I'll give you what they are. because I've memorized them. I want you to memorize them for you, because from the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks.
Yeah.
Right? Okay, so love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, humbleness, and self-control. There's nothing that can come against that. Eternalize that, live by that, act upon that, stand on that, and trust in God on that.
Amen.
And there's no relationship that you can't have, because you will minister to them and show them a light and a way. And for me at this stage of my life, it's about how can I get eternal return on investment.
Well, say a little bit more about that. What does that mean?
So we use this platform called Worldwide Technology and our whole ecosystem to minister to people. Yeah. Well, 3 years ago, we started a prayer call for our partners, for our customers, for our banking community, for our worldwide employees and their families. Everybody can get on this prayer call, and we have prayer. We have a world-class, artists come on. We have BB, we have CC Winan, we have Marvin, we have all these. We have David Sanborn come on and do a couple of things. We had Joy D. Francisco. You name it, we've had opera singers come on there and praising and thanking the Lord and hope. And then we have a world-class speaker come. T.D. Jakes has been on. In fact, I'm asking your pastor to come on there, too. Okay? And then we have prayer. And we're thanking the Lord and we're praising Him. And we started this right in the middle of the pandemic. I said, we want to meet the spiritual needs of people. Because that's where we're broken. Okay? And so out of that, and then we advertised something we started 13 years ago. Biblical business training. And then we used my books and we used other books, and we have just a wonderful reservoir of content where we're actually encouraging Bible study in the workplace.
Amen.
There's no better leadership training than you can get anywhere from the Word of God itself.
Amen.
All right? You want to learn how to lead? Go in the Word. And so we have a number of sales across the country and around the globe in varying businesses. And we have content that we continue to develop, and we have coaches that coach the leaders for those various, and we encourage it in the workplace because we think it's relevant, we think it's significant, and we think it's important to build the kind of culture that's, that's God-centered. If we do that, there's nothing that's not possible.
Amen, amen. All right, let's give David a hand. Now, you're not done yet, but I'm going to bring up the son in whom he's well pleased. Let's show, before he comes up, let's show the video.
Hello everyone, I'm David Steward, CEO and founder of Lion Forge Animation. We founded the company in 2019 with the mission to source, develop, and produce groundbreaking animated content. Our company's DNA is creating impactful entertainment that is rooted in authenticity and dynamically tailored for the ever-changing streaming paradigm, as well as traditional broadcast and beyond. Lion Forge Animation is the only Black-owned full-service animation studio in North America. In our short history, we have assembled a proven team of industry leaders, worked with and delivered for top entertainment companies, and fostered a global network of partners, enabling us to break new ground and embrace opportunities that are strategic. We create content that has not been seen before, captures attention, and receives top honors. We are proud of our efforts and excited about our future. Let us show you what we can do.
And the Oscar goes to Hair Love.
All right, David L. Steward, money-making, Oscar-winning. All right. Now I'm gonna do something a little bit different since we have both of these gentlemen on stage. Animation company in St. Louis.
Yes.
that's a worth of applause right there.
Hey, the wonders that God can do, you know.
Now, how did you? I'm gonna let you guys ask each other a question. But mm-hmm. what do you have a question for David before I start? Now, one thing I have to say that you guys are as innovative as you are. Couldn't you guys think of a different name to call each other? Now, couldn't you think of a different name? Now, he's David the Second, and I think your son is David the Third.
Yeah, or we call him Trey.
Okay. All right. Couldn't you guys like George Foreman? So.
Hey, and my other son is Julian Carl David Stewart.
Is that right? Okay.
Yeah, so.
What? Beloved steward. Beloved servant. What better name could you have?
Man after God's own heart, right?
There you go.
Right. And steward, a manager of God's resources.
That's right.
Did your mother actually think about that? Or your father named you? Who named you?
My mother did. Actually, she opened the Bible, and she named me.
Good. Excellent. All right, David, glad to have you here.
Thank
you. Now, you're younger. Some of these folks are your peers. How did you, now I know you did a number of things. Kind of give us a little bit of your background before you actually started Lion Forge and got into, and tell us how you became interested and got into animation.
It kind of started back in, you know, high school. I had a strong passion for photography at the time, and actually was something, you know, very much encouraged, you know, by my parents. As they mentioned, you know, the time that my dad's car got repossessed, I was a freshman in high school, and my parents made a lot of sacrifices to make sure that, you know, I stayed in that high school. I was at Country Day and MIC/MICDS. At the time, and my sister was over at Whitfield, but you know, I saw what you know, how they put us first and made sure that we got the education, made sure that we had everything we needed. And believe me, at the time too, even them paying for the school, and then me taking on an expensive hobby/interest
right.
as photography. I mean, my parents were always there for me, encouraging that, and then. I went to college, you know, as kind of, I guess I had my head on straight a little bit, so I actually studied business at the time, kind of covering something overarching, wanted to follow my dad's footsteps, and I worked at Worldwide for a couple years, actually, and so in government relations and business development, and I was up in D.C. at the time working there, and my dad would come up, every other month or so to visit, and I was kind of felt this calling to kind of go back into something else in media, kind of follow that passion. And so my dad, I had dinner with him, and he said, if you're doing something you love, you'll never work another day in your life. And so that encouraged me to kind of follow my dreams and passion, which was in visual storytelling, which led to kind of what I do today in animation.
Now, so after watching your mother and father go through those challenges, and you probably wanted to borrow the car that weekend that he got repossessed, right?
It was around the time I was driving, so yes.
So, but seeing that, and most kids don't want to do anything like their father or their mother, right? They want to try to do something different. But what still gave you the interest in starting your own business, even after seeing those challenges?
Well, I think we kind of come from a long line of entrepreneurs. As you mentioned, my grandfather
was in your
DNA. Had entrepreneurial ventures. My dad always, so when he started his first venture in 1983, I was 6 years old. So I do remember working for Federal Express, but then I also remember him starting these companies,
Right.
And when he first started, it wasn't, four people in a space. He was actually working out of our basement.
Wow.
at the time. And we're talking about an unfinished basement, too. So, I saw what it took and the dedication there and, kind of what it meant to him and how he was following his passion. And I also took several trips with him, too. One of the businesses was in St. Joseph, Missouri. So I remember taking these road trips with him and kind of seeing what it takes to be an entrepreneur or be in business. I think that's kind of what kind of struck my interest, at the time. Him following those passions, seeing what it takes to do it, and something I wanted to follow in as well.
Good, good, good. So animation, where did that interest come from specifically?
So in addition to animation, we actually have two comic book publishing companies. So it started with visual storytelling through comics, and then that led to us getting into animation. And so it was kind of that natural progression to wanting to see some of these stories in other media and kind of really pushing the envelope there. I think the other thing too with that is that, in each step of this journey over the last, 13 years, we've been really pushing the envelope and trying to change paradigms and also trying to give opportunities as well. So when we did in comics publishing, we're the only black-owned major comic book publishing company that's out there. And then when I got into animation, one of the things that kind of struck me and was that I went to Kidscreen, which is a place where they buy and sell a majority of the kids' content at the time. And, walked in the space, and I was there with another colleague who's African-American. We're the only black people there. And it kind of struck me. I was like, what's going on here with this industry? And so, there I kind of knew, we were in the right place doing the right thing and trying. And it was important for us to not only establish what we're doing, give opportunities, but also be able to grow and be a beacon for others to kind of come into this industry, especially, African-American, to be able to kind of enumerate where we are in this space.
So you saw that your research, you saw that there was a gap in companies, that animation companies and production companies that actually focused on African-Americans or diverse individuals.
Well, it was less about the gap of companies. It's really, you see it in the result of the content itself. Mm-hmm. So if you look at kind of what's out there, there's, few and far between, shows and featured movies, especially, we're featured in content, but we're not leading the content. Mm-hmm. And so that's the biggest issue. And even if you look back at, some of the popular shows of the last 15 years, there were a couple of them, like Craig of the Creek or Doc McStuffins, those weren't created by us.
Okay.
You know, they feature us, but they weren't created by us. And so, you know, I think it's important for us to have the agency and be able to drive our own voice not only because we should be telling our own stories, but also from an authenticity standpoint.
Yeah.
And so that's been kind of key for us to be able to be that force to make sure that that happens. So with Hair Love, for example, we got involved very early on with Matthew. He had just done a Kickstarter. He was looking to turn this into an animated short. And we were there to step in to make sure that that vision was seen and that his voice was heard throughout that whole process. And actually, a lot of people don't realize that was actually coming together of pretty much a good swath of what was animation. Current animation executives in there. So you had Peter Ramsey, who did Spider-Verse. You had Everett Downing, who worked for Blue Sky. You had Bruce Smith, who created The Proud Family,
right.
All on this one project. So
okay.
We all kind of came together, kind of formed Voltron to make this happen. So, I think there was kind of Lord all bringing us together and kind of seeing the results in that.
So that's so you picked up the relationship, partnership thing from your father as well. Let me ask a nosy question. I know probably these women are thinking about, what did it feel like to win an Oscar?
I mean, it felt great. I mean, I think at the end of the day, those accolades are great. They move the needle. But, at the end of the day, I think what was more important for me is how that content touched lives.
Okay.
And so... the fact, if you go on YouTube now, there's it's up to 100 million views on YouTube of the animated short. But it was the kind of one of those first rare times that little black girls could see themselves in animation on the screen. those are the moments that I think they're most touching. And even in some of the content that you saw. Up there, I don't know if you guys have seen Rise Up, Sing Out on Disney Plus, but if you get a chance to watch it, there's it's a cute, little cute song. So it had music by the Roots, and they did this thing called the Bonnet Song.
Okay.
And so it kind of went viral online, and you had all these little girls now that were felt now empowered and okay to wear their bonnets at night, weren't embarrassed about it. And so, and they would sing the song, and even had. Even found it in a couple of cases, little white girls wanted to wear bonnets too. so it was a great opportunity to kind of for those girls to feel that what we do as black folks is it's okay. It's what we do. It's socializing that to the broader audience and having that. Social integration, social acceptance from a broad sense and understanding, I think is the most important of the things that we do.
Now, looking at your resume and reading the history of the company, I mean, you have a lot of things you're doing. And a lot of the way these kind of describe to us how these projects come together. And I think there's a sequel to Hair Love. Is that, I think I may have read that.
Yep.
But kind of explain, because also, my next question is about vision, but kind of explain a little bit about how these projects come together. The different people. You just mentioned a number of different artists and folks like Questlove that are involved in these different projects. But from St. Louis, here in our fair city, how are you able to reach those folks? I think I saw some stuff about, you just mentioned something on Disney, but it sounds like you're working with a lot of major studios. And a lot of folks, how are those things coming together and how are you able to put that together?
Honestly, I can't explain. It's the Lord. I mean, the Lord's been guiding me the whole way. I think the important thing is that, throughout this whole journey, it's kind of, I have this kind of personal philosophy. It's kind of let go and let God, to my dad's point earlier about, relationships and being of service is so important. I think if you go into any situation from that standpoint, no matter whom you meet, you never know what those relationships can lead to. But if you're there being of service and trying to be helpful to that person, those things in the I always find that they come back, you know, in some way, shape, or form.
Right.
You never know where things are coming from. So even, you know, even between myself and my dad, I mean, we're in separate industries. I never thought, you know, any of his relationships would matter in my ecosystem. But, mm-hmm. you know, lo and behold, what, a few years ago, AT&T buys Warner Brothers. And right. so relationship there pretty immediately. And so, again, and, you know, he's always, you know, told me, hey, you know, I want you to meet these folks, that folks. And, you know, it's always being open to the people that God puts in your life. And again, you never know where it leads. And maybe now, maybe 10, 20 years down the road, mm-hmm. you don't know. And I think that's kind of how organically we've been able to make and build these relationships over time. And you know, things have, you know, and God has put things in our place to, you know, get us to where we are now.
Good. Excellent. Now,
I will give you one other story though.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of similar between you and your dad. So,
okay.
The project that we're working on right now, it's a project called Yanu, which was on screen. But so we talk about kind of God's grace and not giving up. So, Rory Okupe, who created that particular property, he had a graphic novel. And so he had brought it to us a few years ago when we were in the middle of doing an acquisition merger. And unfortunately, you know, in that whole situation, because we weren't really taking on things, you know, we had to, you know, reject publishing his book. So he ended up publishing it with another publisher. Mm-hmm. But, you know, he always, you know, wanted to work with us and maintain the relationship and things. And so lo and behold, a few years later, project kind of comes back to us in the animation form. And so we ended up, you know, partnering with him, bringing that project forth to HBO Max. And, you know, now we have a two-season, two-film pickup. And I always tell people Excellent. All the time, you know, you never know, you know, what All those right. things are going to lead. And one other thing in that, too, when we first started our comic book publishing company back in 2011, you know, we were going around trying to find people to work with us, because comic book industry is very insular, and some of these artists and writers and stuff, they don't know who you are. They're very skittish about working with you. So, you know, we even went to the point and said, hey, we'll pay you half up front. And they were like, I don't know. You know? But so we went to a panel, and this guy stood up and, you know, asked this question, and he had, you know, talked about some of the work they was doing and everything. I went up to him. His name was Brandon Easton. Went up to him afterwards, and I said, hey, you know, we're starting this company. Would love to work with you. And he said, yeah, here's my card. I'll work with you guys, blah, blah, blah. So ended up being the first writer we worked with. And he also was a big evangelist for us as well, in terms of building relationships for us. So as his career has gone, he's worked for Disney Writers Program, did some other things. And so on Iyanu, we were able to give him the opportunity for him to be a showrunner on that show. And if you guys don't know what showrunners are, pretty much like the person that's going to manage and run the story doing that. And so, and if you look at the animation industry especially, I could probably count on my hand how many black showrunners are out there. And so we were able to, you know, work with him, give that opportunity. So you kind of see how things kind of come full circle with, you know, the various relationships, how, you know, you could be a blessing in that.
Amen. 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 I'm going to ask you about vision, but did you feel pressure to win Oscar because your sister had one more?
Absolutely.
Just think about that.
I can't have my little sister beat me. Unless, you know.
Oh, okay. All right. No, I understand.
She'll definitely tell you that.
Right. Well, his daughter, Kim, and David, I mean, remember when they were very young kids. Now, this is how I know how much David has progressed. When we first started going to, our families used to go to see Regina and I, and before we had kids, and then we had kids, so we would all go. We would go see the Nutcracker. Was it Nutcracker? No. Christmas Carol, every year at the Fox. So at first, I had the Banks box. So I would invite him to come, and, you know, so, and then we would go across the street to the Best Day House. And I would treat on the Banks card. As he started to prosper, we started going to, well, he had his own box, so he would invite us to the box, and then he would take us to Ruth Chris or some other places, and he would foot the whole bill. So you could see that transition. Okay, you must be doing pretty well. You don't need me anymore. But I remember these guys when they were very, very young kids, very young, and they've grown up to do outstanding things. You have a question or a comment about your son's success or anything you want to ask him since we have you here? And I'm going to ask him the same thing. You know, if he has a question for you that he wanted to ask, was afraid to ask, but now he's in public, he can ask it.
What is the thing that spiritually, what is the thing that has driven you more than anything else as you think back? There's always an event that happens or something that tucks your heart or a call by whether it's someone that inspires you to do what you do.
That's a good question.
That's hard, man. Tough.
That is a tough one.
Should have sent him that one in advance.
Go ahead. You know, I don't think there's a moment. I think, and again, I'll throw this back on you, is that every time I've had a challenge, every time, you know, I had a disappointment, and you know, I get a little fiery too, because. I try to be as patient as my dad a lot of times, but I think I got some fire from my mother in a lot of ways. And so, you know, there's always kind of a word of encouragement that I've gotten from my father. There's always the optimism mm-hmm. I've gotten from my father. There's always the word as well as I got from my father. Every day I wake up, I get two text messages in our group text box from my father and mother, giving scriptures and the word of the day to start off our day, and you know, get us centered, you know, and those things are important, and again, it helps me to, you know, be patient, learn to, you know, wait on God, because you know, as I've seen, you know, in my lifetime. You know, the things that you force to make happen sometimes because you want them are not necessarily the things that are gonna turn out well for you. You know, the things that you kind of, when God puts something in your path, it just all works out right. You don't have to, you know, it's kind of effortless. And so kind of being in that, always being in that kind of, that stream is very important, but it's kind of hard because you get all these distractions. You know, especially being an entrepreneur, you have employees, you have bills to pay, you have all these other things and all these distractions. But you have to kind of have clarity of purpose and kind of what you're doing and vision to kind of see through all of that.
Excellent. Your turn. We got one for him. And my last question. And I don't know if there are any questions from the audience, but we had asked you guys to write them down if you do have something, but we're just about completed here. But and my last question for both of you guys is about vision and then kind of the last word of advice you would give to young entrepreneurs. But you have a question for me, anything? But you know, you live with them all your life, so you may know everything already.
You know, I end up asking questions all the time.
Right, so. Right.
And some of it, you know, I've lived through, so.
Right.
I guess, you know, through your journey as an entrepreneur, what was the most difficult thing that you had to get through and overcome in that journey?
Disappointing people.
Let me grab the mic there.
I think disappointing people that were dependent upon me. And having the courage to fight through. You know, I said this to a couple people just the other day, or I may have said this even today for that matter. Our people don't work for me, I work for them. Mm. For them and their families and, you know, have the courage and have the faith where they may not have that. As well, and they have to see that in me. They have to see the the excitement and the eager anticipation on what God is going to do, what I'm going to do, but I got to show, God's going to show through me his light in a way that they will be encouraged and inspired by that. And there's a ministry in that too, you know, and walking in faith, you know, who do you have faith in, you know, when I'm doing this? I have faith in God, because I'll disappoint you every time. I have to have that inspiration from God. So I read God's word every morning, and I share the word of God with my kids every morning and other folk that need encouragement every day and need a reminder every day. And it says, given it will be given to you, right? Well, I getting that back too, right? 30, 60, 100 fold, pressed down, shaken together, and flowing over, right? And so I would say what inspires me is seeing the many people in our organization and our ecosystem and with our platform that are seeing God through that. And especially persons of color that may not necessarily see themselves as worthy, or see themselves as entrepreneurs, or see themselves as Ephesians 3:20 sees them, or as God sees them. Because when I saw that Ephesians 3:20, I almost it changed my life. Because what I will say to you is that I saw myself for the first time as the child of the king, a joint heir in Christ Jesus, Abraham's seed, which just changed my life and how I thought and what I thought was possible. All things are possible through Christ who strengthens us. Amen. Those things start to come alive in me. And so, you know, as I look back and continue to look forward to, and with eager anticipation on what God is going to do next, and it always is exceedingly above all you can think, dream, or pray for.
All right, last question. So, what is God going to do next? What's the vision after $17 billion now worldwide is the number one African American owned company in the country, but number 27th largest privately held company. It may be higher than that now since you're at 17 and not 15. But what do you still see? Do you still have a vision?
God spoke to me several years ago. He said, I want you giving away $1 billion a year. And and he said, he spoke to me and said, 3 months later, he says to me, it's a small math problem. Not even small math, it's a rounding error for the Lord, right? And then he said, worldwide is a seed to be sown. Now you think about that. A $17 billion company is a seed to be sown. So I think about this, and there is a strategy around that, a virtuous cycle of capital that can be created out of that. And I think in terms, you know, I used to be a really good thousandaire. That was really good.
Right. Really good. You got to be a thousandaire before you can become a millionaire.
But you know, in order to be a millionaire, you have to think in those terms, right? And you have to be a really good millionaire, because lay people get stuck in thousandaire and can never get to millionaire because they're not sowing seed like a millionaire and serving like a millionaire and a commitment like a millionaire, right? That's how you become a billionaire, right? And you got to... But so it continues in that. And so for our, you know, I think in terms of trillions, because we serve markets of trillions, and we want to transform markets of trillions, and how we develop technology is in trillions. God inspired, and with the algorithms and the Spirit, and folding the power of the Holy Spirit into the algorithms of the development of AI and artificial intelligence, so you have a true North Star, so you don't have unintended consequences associated, so it fulfills its purpose in serving in a way. So I think in those terms today, as I think about whether it's worldwide or the platform that includes worldwide as a part of it. And the Steward Family platform, and how we, whether it's media or whether it's the stuff that we're doing with technology at worldwide and the various industries that we serve, or whether it's and how we're giving and so forth as well. All of it is a ministry.
Amen. Amen. And this is one of the largest philanthropists in our community. Boy Scouts, even though in Clinton, Missouri, when they turned you down to be in the Boy Scouts, I mean, again, the right people stood up at the right time and you became a Boy Scout there. But I know you're a major supporter of the Boy Scouts and the Urban League, and I mean, there's all kinds of things. You're part owner in the Blues. Sam, if you have that picture, you can put it up, both of them. And I'm going to ask you kind of what you guys kind of collaborate on together. But I mean, you're just, you know, you've done a tremendous amount of work here in the local community. And I know you're, I'm going to watch your work nationally as well. I don't know so much about the global work, but I'm sure you're doing things on a global basis because the companies, those 55 companies are there. This is them at the Blues game when the Blues won the first Stanley Cup, right?
Yes.
And you guys went on the ice, and they said, what are these black guys doing on the ice? They must be lost.
They thought we had lost our way. We were only the flies in the milk. So we've been owners of the, one of the owners in the Blues since 2013. Mm-hmm. I think that's right. A lot of people. and we did it not for investment purpose. We did it because we wanted to keep the Blues in St. Louis.
Here, here, here.
Actually, and I tell this story, and it's really, really not true, but really, I thought it was a blues band because I don't know anything about hockey. He doesn't either. We don't watch it either. We don't know the blue line from the black line to the gray line.
I heard the first
and we don't
game,
know none about
the first game you went to. You were about to leave. And then the second period, they say, wait a minute, there's another period.
Yeah, that's true. That's a true story. And one of our people gave me a book that said, Hockey for Dummies, you know, and I've gone to, even with the playoffs and all that stuff, I've gone to a total of 8 games in my entire life, and I've got signage down there, we've got
barking, all that stuff,
as an owner, and all the owner's box, all that stuff, you know, and a whole bit, but, you know, we did it for another reason. And then we did it for another reason as well, because we wanted black kids and our charity to experience that in a box and have food and that whole bit. And they have opportunity to see that for the first time. We did the same thing in racing as well. I mean,
yeah, right, racing with Bubba Wallace. We're about out of time, but I wanted to, before you give your answer on vision, which is another thing I think you guys, part of the DNA. I heard an answer you gave on a recent interview that kind of shocked me, because the guy asked, where do you see your company in the next 5 years? And you said you don't think in those terms, but I'm gonna have you answer that vision question in just a minute. I wanna recognize Max St. Clark, who's come to see David. She's the founder of Build-A-Bear. And you know, whereas, oh, there's, okay, over there, she is back there. But you know your product is famous when it gets mentioned in a Marvel movie. You know, Tony Stark, when he first saw the rocket, you know, the one that Thor calls a rabbit, and he was talking. He said, I thought that was a Build-A-Bear. And so you know you're famous when it gets mentioned in the biggest Marvel movie of all time, Endgame. Maxine, stand up. There she is. And that's a whole nother story of how she was in the retail business and started that company, which is, again, became went public, had private equity investors. I'm familiar with some of the story, but appreciate you coming out tonight. David, vision. So I heard you answer that question. You don't think in 5-year increments, but you kind of talked about 20 years and kind of where you see and where do you want Lion Forge and Polarity, your holding company, to go.
For us, you know, I think we're going to be, you know, every bit as, you know, big size-wise as, you know, Disney or beyond. You know, for us, it's about, you know, how do we change an industry? As I mentioned, you know, if you look at some of the numbers right now, and we actually looked at some industry numbers, we look at, you know, black and brown participation in the industry from a directorial producing side of things. And it comes out in the content as well. I mean, just look at the number of projects that are out there that are diverse. Right. You know, there's a dearth. And if you get into the animation industry, it's a fraction of that, you know. Oh. And so what we want to do is, you know, change the industry. We want to have more content paradigms for black, Hispanic, Asian, et cetera, you know, across the paradigm. But we also want it to be built and done by the people that we're representing on the screen. Part of that too is growing and being able to give opportunities. And so, while our headquarters is here in St. Louis, we also have some things that are being built out in Atlanta as well, where there's a number of HBCUs that we're going to be connecting with to kind of provide pipelines and things like that. We've also provided some pipelines here. We actually do a program with Jennings High School to expose students to both animation and comics. And so these are kind of pilot things that we've done up until this point, but I want to see that expanded and enumerated in a significant way to, you know, provide those pathways and opportunities so that we can give those opportunities at that level.
So you want to be at the level where Disney is. I think you said something about creating characters that could last, you know, that like a lifetime.
Absolutely, and I think through our content as well, it's how do we inspire that next generation too. So whether we put people in different seats or give opportunities in that way, but the content is powerful as well. You know, how do we socialize to that next generation? Them seeing themselves in new and different ways. When we talk about, you mentioned STEM education and the work that you're doing with the high school, it's very important for our next generation of, you know, black and brown, especially youth, to be able to see themselves in engineering careers, see themselves as rocket scientists, see themselves as chemical engineers, et cetera. And that's not being done right now. And so we want to be able to inspire that generation with our content too.
Excellent, excellent. Now, hopefully you guys picked up on what our purpose of for having this is, to bring two gentlemen here, St. Louis's own, that have, you heard about them. Now, if I had won an Oscar and had started an animation company, I'd be pretty happy. You know, I think I could rest on that for like 5, 6, 10 years. He's talking about changing the industry. So that's where his mind is. David started a company and did things nobody else had ever done before. $17 billion in sales. So what I want you guys to leave here with is just, I want you to think bigger. I mean, as God-fearing people, we shouldn't put God in a box. We shouldn't limit God. I mean, we should think about things on an unlimited basis. That's what these two guys think about. So don't just think about, you know, starting, you know, think about obviously starting a company. You got to get started. It's going to take hard work and faith. But think big. Don't limit God. I mean, that's what I see when I have these two gentlemen sitting here next to me. The kind of things that they've done and the kind of vision that they have is really exciting. And I want to, I saw in your book where you had dedicated dedicated to your kids, Kim, David, and Mary, and you have room for Regina and me? am I down in there? I missed that part in the small print. But let's give these gentlemen a hand and thank them for their time. Excellent job. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Excellent. Excellent job. I'm over time, so they got to make their way out. We didn't talk about the book, Leadership, Buy the Good Book. That's on sale in the lobby. Make sure you get that. If you get that book, Leadership, Buy the Good Book, it'll have a number of stories in it about what David was talking about tonight, his various experiences going through business, the different challenges that he had. You want to get that book and read it. You'll learn a lot from it, some of the things that we couldn't cover here tonight. But thank you all for your attention.